brothers and sisters. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for calling us in your house of worship this morning, Father, where we can gather together, whether it be here in the building, Father, or across the medium of the internet, Father. We just thank you for this opportunity you give us to gather together and worship together as one family under your leadership. Father God, as we worship this morning, Lord, we ask that you pour your Spirit out upon this place. Lord, we ask that you might fill every heart, Father, empower every person, Father. Lord, help us to respond to you, Father. Help us to become more like your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, it's in his name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to First Baptist Church of Flagler Beach. I'm so glad that we can all gather here together this morning. Let me get my eyeballs on. I can say a little bit about what's going on. First off, this coming Wednesday night, we are having a ladies' gathering at 1 o'clock in the fellowship hall. And I believe that is for all ladies. I'm trying to find Debbie in there. That's for all ladies, young or old, members or not members. Everybody's invited. Is that right? Everybody. It'll be 1 o'clock. They're going to have all kinds of games. And so look out. We'll see if the building's still standing by the time they're done with it. And so also coming up, let's see. Vacation Bible School. We are still dusty. We need one more helper, you say? At least one more helper? Okay, we always have last-second needs. If you're available to help with Vacation Bible, please see the lovely lady on my left. She's our Vacation Bible School director. We are looking forward to another good one. One of the things as pastor I've learned, I've got to pay attention to what's going on because I gave you some bad information last week about the Alpha Pregnancy fundraiser. What this is they've got a bunch of baby bottles out there. They encourage everyone to take home, and then when you get spare change from the grocery store or from wherever, put it in the baby bottle, and then we're going to send that on to the Alpha Pregnancy Center. If you're not familiar with the Alpha Pregnancy Center, they help out women in crisis pregnancies. This could be someone facing financial difficulties or family situations or what have you. It is an alternative to terminating the pregnancy. And so this is a ministry that's helped a lot of people. I know some of the women that have been impacted by this ministry, and it is an amazing thing. So I'd like to encourage everyone to participate in this. And also, just a minor note, next week, Dustin, I looked around and realized we've got some vacation time because of the pandemic we were never able to use. So next Sunday, I'm taking off. Y'all won't see me next Sunday. And so, but we'll be back. And so, but if you need me, you know, I'm only a phone call away, but I look forward to coming back. 9 o'clock in the morning, that Sunday morning, we'll be having Asa Greer, and then 11 o'clock is going to be Al Kador. Barry knows him. If he messes up, it's Barry's fault. And so, but at any rate, Debbie, you had something. It was supposed to be through Mother's Day and Father's Day, but you know we're going to continue on with that. And again, let me encourage everyone to prayerfully consider how you can support that ministry. And so that's all the announcements that I've got. Let's worship. I'm going to go to the next slide. This morning, I'd like to shine a spotlight on some of our missionaries that responded to God's call to go to the end of the earth, James and Jen Cho. They're serving in the city of Calgary in the province of Alberta in Canada. And I understand that Calgary, 95% of the population has not professed Jesus as Lord and Savior. 95%. That means it is a mission field in desperate need of messengers. And James and Jen have responded to God's call. And this church is helping support them through our prayers and through our finances. 10% of all of our offerings go to missions. 3% to local missions through the St. John's Association. 7% to the cooperative programs that supports missionaries such as James and Jen. Also supports different seminaries we have around and other ministries around the world. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for James and for Jen, Father, for their obedience to you, Father, to go to the people of Calgary. Father, we pray for their ministry, Father. We pray for the people that are reaching out, Father. We pray they might continue to be fruitful, Father. They might continue to be effective. Father God, this morning we pray for all of our missionaries around the world, here in North America, in South America, in Africa, in Europe, in Asia, Australia, the Pacific Islands. Father God, we just ask that you watch over each and every one, Father. Help them to continue to share the message that Jesus saved. Father, we love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. pray. You always remember those who are hurting. This morning I'd like to ask us especially to pray for Ann Benton. She is at home continuing to recover. There is some rehabilitation. Also, I understand we still need some people to provide some meals for them and the family. Okay, if you'd like to be included in that, please see Debbie. Debbie, show your hand up so everybody can see who you are. See the nice lady with her hand up. If you'd like to help out with some meals, please see her. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. First of all, then, I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority, in order that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony born at the proper time. And for this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I am not lying. As a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. God desires all men to be saved and become men. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, as we gather here together this day under your leadership, Father, with the guidance of your Spirit, Father, we come offering praises with our voices, with our hearts, Father. We come offering praises with everything that we are, Father. We come praising you because you are the God who created each and every one of us, Father. You created us in your image, Father, and you gave us life. Father God, you also have given us this world to live in, Father, and the ability to choose good or evil. Father, we confess and acknowledge this day that we have not always chosen good, Father. We have sometimes chosen that which was evil, that which was wrong, Father. We have sinned against you. So, Father, we come asking for forgiveness, Father. Father, we come acknowledging our need for you, Father. Father God, we come acknowledging that we still need your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to live, to die, to rise again, Father, to pay the price that we could not pay. Father God, we thank you for that gift of forgiveness, that gift of redemption, Father, for the reconciliation between us and you. Father God, we also thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit that brings comfort and counsel, your Holy Word which gives guidance and instruction. Father God, we thank you for the privilege of living in a nation such as this where we may worship you openly and freely. Father God, we pray for all of our elected officials across this great nation, Father, here in Flagler Beach and Flagler County, in Tallahassee and in Washington. Father God, we pray for the people of the United States of America, that they might hear your voice, they might respond to you. Father God, we pray for an awakening in this nation, Father, where we might respond and say, yes, you are our God. Father God, we pray for those who are sick, Father. We pray for those who are still struggling with the virus. Father, we pray for those places where the outbreak is still strong, Father. Places like India and other places around the world, Father. We pray for doctors and nurses, those who are on the front lines, Father. Father God, we pray for those who are sick, those who are ill, those who are injured. Father, we especially pray for Ann, Father. Lord, we pray for swift recovery, Father, for effective rehabilitation, Father, for relief from the pain. Father God, as we continue to serve you, Father, help us to remember that you have called all men to come to you, Father, that you do not desire anyone to not be saved, Father. Lord, help us to simply carry that message that Jesus saves any who would come to him. Father, we love you, we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus.
tip my hat to the praise team. They're here every week practicing, and then they have to sit through two worship services on a given Sunday morning. And so I appreciate them coming and serving and doing all that they do. There was a story floating around missionary circles years ago about a missionary station somewhere in a third world country where you had missionaries would come in there, be there for 2 or 3 years, and then they'd rotate and somebody else would come in. And they had this car there had been donated by somebody. And when the next missionary came in, he was told, okay, this car runs pretty good once it gets started, but in order to start this thing, you've got to push it off. You've got to get it in gear, kind of push it down a hill and jump in and pop the clutch, and it'll start. Okay, you've got to do what you got to do. And so he learned after a while that you had to kind of plan ahead when you went into a place because you had to park the car in a place where you could push it down a hill just a little bit. And so over the months he was there, he learned how to adjust for this. And then when the next missionary came in, he said, okay, here's your house and here's your car and here's how this works. Well, the next missionary had been an auto mechanic prior to becoming a missionary. He says, let's take a look at this. And he opened up the hood and he looked at the starter and he said, oh, here's your problem right here. This connection's loose. Click. Turn the key. It cranked up just like it was supposed to. The missionary's like, you've got to be kidding me. I've been pushing this thing off now for 3 years, and all that was wrong with it was one loose connection. That one loose connection kept that car from having all the power that it needed. Someone paraphrased Ephesians 1, 19 and 20 like this. He says, how tremendous is the power available to us who believe in God. When we make our firm connection with God, His life and power flow through us. Having a solid connection to God. I want to talk about someone in the apostles that they did not have as solid a connection with God as they needed to. And when you consider which apostle this was, he cannot have been the only one that was like this. I want to talk about Peter this morning. He was one of the leaders of the apostle. And an issue that God brought up before the early church, that if Peter struggled with this, I guarantee you 99% of the rest of the church was going to struggle with this. Peter had grown up in a Jewish household. He had been taught the law from the time that he was born about what you could and could not do on the Sabbath, on Saturday, on the foods that you could not eat. And he had learned from an early age that if it was a land animal, it had to have a cloven hoof and it had to chew the cud. So you could eat beef, you could eat lamb, you could not eat pork. If it came out of the water, if it was a fish, it had to have scales and it had to have fins, which means like catfish was out. I could not live without my catfish and my bacon, I can tell you that right now. But Peter grew up understanding these are the rules. And he had been faithful to them as much as anybody had. And of course, he met Jesus and he followed Jesus and accepted Jesus. He received Jesus. And then Jesus died, rose again, ascended to heaven. And Peter was one of the leaders of the apostles of this first century church. Last week we talked about how he was called into Joppa. And there Tabitha had passed away. And Peter was there, and then he asked that Tabitha, arise. Jesus Christ has resurrected you. He has brought you back. And Tabitha rose. And everyone was astounded. And Peter stayed there in Joppa, ministering, witnessing, testifying. And Scripture says that many, many people came to receive Christ because of Peter and his ministry and his witness. Then one day, Peter had a vision. He was up on top of his house praying. It was about noon, and he was getting hungry. It was lunchtime. And he looked up and he saw this giant sheet come down, and it was filled with snakes and pigs and catfish and all kinds of animals that he would have despised up until now. He's looking at this filled with all kinds of animals that would be considered unclean. And the voice called out, arise and eat. I don't eat that. Your word to the Hebrews was, don't eat this kind of food. The sheet came down again, arise and eat. No, this is unclean. I cannot eat this? It came down a third time. Arise and eat. This is unclean. And God said, if I made it, it's not unclean. And then the vision disappeared, and there was a knock. You see, there was another man just a few days before that he had a vision. He'd had an encounter. And this was someone that was very different from Peter. He grew up eating pork. He grew up eating whatever kind of shellfish. He grew up eating, you know, whatever his family could get. His name was Cornelius, and he was a Roman soldier. Not just a Roman soldier, he was a Roman centurion, which meant he had been a very successful soldier, and he had demonstrated his leadership capabilities, and he had demonstrated his loyalty to the Roman Empire. This was not just some private running around. This was a centurion, someone who commanded approximately 100 soldiers. And Scripture says that he had been a good man by first century standards. He had given to the poor. He had helped people. And this was unusual for a centurion. Usually centurions come in and they're like the occupying force. These people were not welcomed by the local population, especially this population with so many Jews, so many Hebrews. He was considered the enemy by so many people, especially people like Simon the Zealot, who just simply wanted the Romans to go home. This man was praying. Now I want you to think about this just a second. Here we have a man who is not saved. He is lost. He is praying to God. God hears his prayer. God answers his prayer. Chew on that for just a little bit. The voice says to him, we've heard your prayers. We've seen what you have done. Send to Joppa. There is a man there named Peter in the house of Simon the Tanner. Send for him. And then the vision ended. He called a couple of his servants. One of his soldiers that apparently was like-minded him in terms of believing in God. And he said, go to Joppa. And they went to Joppa. It's about a 40-mile walk from Caesarea to Joppa. You could do it in a day's time, but it's a long, hard day. It took them a while to get everything together. And then once they got there, they had to find the tanner's house. When they found it, they knocked on the door. And they asked for one called Peter. Open up the Bible so we could at least Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse 24. Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse 24. And on the following day, he, talking about Peter, entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together his relatives and close friends. And it came about that when Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter raised him up, saying, stand up, I too am just a man. And as he talked with him, he entered and found many people assembled. And he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a man who is a Jew to associate with a foreigner or visit him. And yet God has shown me I should not call any man holy or unclean. That is why I came without even raising the objection. For when I was sent for, and so I asked for what reason you have sent for me. Cornelius said, 4 days ago to this hour, I was praying in my house during the ninth hour. And behold, a man stood before me in shining garments. And he said, Cornelius, your prayers have been heard. Your alms have been remembered before God. Send therefore to Joppa and invite Simon, who is also called Peter, to come to you. He is staying at the house of Simon the Tanner by the sea. And so I sent you immediately, and you have been kind enough to come. Now then, we are all here present before God to hear all that you have commanded by the Lord. And opening his mouth, Peter said, I most certainly understand now that God is not one to show partiality, but in every nation, the man who fears him and does what is right is welcome to him. Amen and amen. Here we have what would be considered in that day and time a shocking development in the history of the church. not a physical change, but a spiritual change. He had, by the end of it, a new attitude and a stronger connection to God. He saw himself, his people, those around him in a completely different light. But Peter had changed. Peter's connection to God was not as solid as he thought it was. If you asked him before he went up on that roof to pray, on a scale of 1 to 10, how's your connection to God? He probably would have said, oh, at least a 9.5, because after all, he spent 3 years walking with Jesus. He had been arrested. He had been beaten by the Jewish authorities. He had been there when Tabitha was brought back to life. And yet, even he had some issues. Understand about Peter. Peter had always seen himself as a Jew, which he was. The problem was he didn't get what this meant. In verse 28, he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a man who is a Jew to associate with a foreigner. This was not in the law of Moses. This was in the secular law that the Jews themselves established at that point in that time. And the rationale behind that was, if they went to a foreigner's house, they might have to eat food that was not considered kosher. And in fact, that's why those kosher laws had been established to begin with, was to make sure that the people of Israel stayed separate from the other people around them, so that when the Messiah came, there would be no question that he was born of the house of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and David. They had to maintain their purity, and they had to maintain their spiritual faithfulness. There could be no question about who the Messiah was. The people had to maintain their faithfulness to God, and they knew that if they intermingled with the other people, they would fall into idolatry. That's what happened to so many of the northern tribe of Israel during that time period. The problem with this was the attitude that developed. Looking back at verse 28, it's unlawful for a man who is a Jew to associate with a foreigner or to visit him, and yet God has shown me that I should not call any man unholy or unclean. Right. God had to explain to Peter, one of the leaders of the apostles, one of the leaders of the early Christian church, not to call some other person unholy or unclean. Do you get that? God actually had to tell Peter. It took a vision for God to get this across to Peter, that guess what? You're not any better than those guys. You're not any more righteous. You're not any more holy. What he didn't get, he understood that the Jewish people were a special people chosen by God. But what he didn't get was they were not chosen because they were special. They were special because they were chosen. Does that make sense to you? They were not any better than any of them, than the Amorites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Edomites. God called them because he had something in mind. They weren't chosen because they were special. They were special because they were chosen. Peter, like so many people in his day and time, saw himself as being above the other nations. What you have here is pride. Peter's connection to God was impaired, number one, by his pride. What he also didn't get is that a heritage, a genetic heritage, is nothing to brag about, no matter what's back in the tree. Some of y'all heard me talk about some of the nuts that I found in my family tree when I started digging this back there. Let me tell you something. I've got some colorful characters. There's one on my mom's side that he died of malaria, but they said the alcoholism didn't help. There's some other things up there. When I'm looking at the last name, I think there's an Hanky Moore on somewhere. I could tell you some stories that come out of my family. Let me call your attention also to Jesus' family tree. Sometimes when you've got a few minutes, open up the book of Matthew and look at Jesus' family tree. You've got Judah. You know, the founding father of the tribe of Judah. He had this little thing with a woman called Tamar. You also later on had a woman by the name of Rahab become a part of that tree. those two got hooked up, don't you?
Okay.
Most of the kings of Judah were in Jesus' family tree. That includes Priests, figure. And yet, at the end of that was Jesus. Anyone who sees other people as being less important than themselves has a pride problem. Anyone who sees anyone else, regardless of the reason, as being lesser than themselves has a pride problem. God has shown me I should not consider call any man unholy or unclean. It took a vision for Peter to get that. Right? So he says, why am I here? And they say, God commanded us, and Cornelius told about the vision that he had, about the angel saying, call for Simon Peter. And he says, we want to hear what you've got to say. And so in the following passages that we didn't get into, he shares the gospel. He talks about Jesus who died, who rose again, and about he can bring salvation to whoever comes to him. Funny thing is, Peter knew the Bible, what we call the Old Testament. He lived through the Gospels. And yet he was surprised that Cornelius is responding. This was the man who was there. He didn't just read about Jesus telling about the Good Samaritan. He was there when Jesus told about the Good Samaritan. When he says, what does it mean to love your neighbor? And Jesus used a Samaritan as an example. Okay? He was there. He heard it. He saw it. But he didn't understand it completely. He understood that Jesus would one day rule all the nations. But what he did not get was that Jesus also brought salvation and forgiveness to all the nations. And I cannot help but wondering if part of what he was doing was looking at the Roman Empire and saying, oh, that's how it's going to be when Jesus comes back. Because the Roman Empire, you had the Romans that conquered everybody, and they ruled the entire Mediterranean basin, plus a good part of Western Europe. But as the Romans were kind of the ruling class and everyone else was sort of underneath them, Peter seems to think that, oh, that's what it's going to be like when Jesus comes back. The Jews are going to be the ruling class. God's like, no, that ain't the way this is going to work. God sent his son that whosoever might believe in him. He didn't get that Jesus would bring that forgiveness to all the nations. This, what was happening here, is a big deal. This is the first time on at least a large scale that non-Jewish people were receiving and accepting Christ. It took a literal vision from God to get Peter even go into the man's house. Peter, for all of his training as a Hebrew, did not know, nor did he understand God's word. So Peter's connection to God was impaired by, number one, his pride, and number two, by his poor understanding of God's word. He knew it, he could recite it, but he didn't get it. You know, y'all remember who the Hebrew people had their start with, don't you? Who did the Hebrew nation start with? Shout it out, somebody. Abraham. All right? And if you remember when God spoke to Abraham, he made him a promise. He said, I'm going to make you the father of many nations. And he also said, I am going to bless all nations through you. So from the very beginning, it should have been understood that the message of Judaism, the message of the Messiah, was not just for Abraham and his people. It was going to be for all nations. And yet, Peter missed it. This was a fundamental part of the Jewish faith that a lot of people just completely missed. God's people did not necessarily understand God's word. He could recite passage after passage after passage, but he didn't get a lot of it. I cannot emphasize enough the necessity of God's people being familiar with God's word. I cannot emphasize enough the necessity of God's people being familiar with God's word. It was given for a reason. There was a pastor named Gypsy Smith who told of a man who said he received no inspiration from the Bible. He says, I've gone through it several times. And Gypsy told him, he says, how about instead of you going through it, how about you let it go through you? And then see what a difference that makes. Peter's connection to God was impaired by his pride, by his poor understanding of God's word. Hang on, we're not quite there yet. The thing is, Peter had seen the Roman centurion. He'd seen the Roman soldiers. But the idea that they might accept Jesus? No. There was a miniseries that came on a few years ago that covered the book of Acts. And y'all remember the one I'm talking about. It was a pretty good miniseries in some ways. It kind of made mincemeat of the plot of the book of Acts, but it did a really good job of showing the characters of these people and the fact that there was a lot that happened betwixt and between these stories that we don't really know what happened. And that a conversation that Luke takes about three measures to three verses to a scribe could have taken like all afternoon for them to figure out, are we going to do this or are we going to do that? It told the story of Cornelius, and it told, you know, he was there in the middle of all this, and someone's asking, who is this guy? And Peter says, oh, that's Cornelius. Well, how do you know him? He says, I baptized him last week. You did what? Absolutely floored at the idea that they would baptize this guy into the church. Someone said, okay, I get that the Samaritans can be included in this because Jesus talked to the Samaritans, and we had the Ethiopian dude, and, you know, he was already part of the faith. And other Gentiles, I can get that. But Romans? There have been Roman soldiers everywhere, but this is the first one that Peter witnesses to. Peter understood that even though Cornelius was doing some good things, that was not enough. It was going to take faith in Jesus Christ. Peter also understood wrongly that God would simply allow all these people to die without any hope. But here's the real problem. He had seen the Romans, he had seen the centurions, and it didn't bother him that they were going to go to hell without Jesus Christ. His connection to God was impaired by his pride, by his poor understanding of God's word, and by his indifference. Up until the point he had been content to simply preach to the Jews and the Gentiles, oh well, not my problem, not my people. Are we any better? We see people all around us, and yet we fail to make eye contact with people that are different. One of the greatest problems in the church today is not that we don't believe lost people go to hell. We do believe that. It's just that to too large of a degree, we've stopped caring. It needs to bother us when someone dies without having received Christ, without having accepted Christ. It needs to bother us that some people don't have Christ in their lives. When I was in seminary, I had an ethics professor. He was a great guy, sort of a maverick on staff, from what I understand. He told about when he was pastoring a church one time, and he and the deacons have been praying about sharing the gospel in their city, to the First Baptist Church of wherever. And they came to the conclusion, and this was a good conclusion to come to, that every house needed to have a Bible somewhere inside. Every house needs to have a copy of God's Word. And so they prayed about this, and they came to the conclusion they needed to buy a bunch of Bibles, and they wanted to make sure that every house inside the city limits that wanted a Bible should have a Bible. So they got out maps, and they started organizing. They ordered, you know, thousands of Bibles. And every afternoon the deacons would meet. They just go up and down a certain number of streets. They'd knock on the door and say, I'm so-and-so from First Baptist Church. Is there a Bible in this house? And if the answer was yes, they'd say thank you, and they'd move on to the next house. If they answered no, they'd say, would you like a Bible? And if they didn't want one, that was fine. But if they didn't have one and they wanted one, they had a free Bible from this church. And Dr. Truel says everything went great as long as we were covering the white neighborhoods. But then it came time to go across the railroad tracks. this side of the tracks. You still with me? Y'all know what I mean? And the thing is, in that town especially, the people on this side of the tracks had one skin color. People on this side of the tracks had a different skin color. Dr. Trill says, okay, I'm off the railroad. Wait a second. We're not inviting them to church, are we? Dr. Trill says, well, I didn't think we were inviting anybody to church. We're just passing out Bible. That's all we're doing. Well, okay. They had driven past these neighborhoods for years and never gave a thought as to whether these people were lost or saved. Trill said that one weekend that had been so concerned about this took a stack of Bibles, knocked on the first door. African-American man came to the door, and he went to his bill, my name's so-and-so, First Baptist Church. We want to make sure that every house that holds a Bible has a Bible. Is there a Bible in this house? And the man says, thank you for coming. I'm so glad that you're here. I actually have a Bible. He says, but I got a lot of my neighbors to come. He says, I actually serve as a deacon in such and such a Baptist church down the street. And the two of them, all of a sudden, they got into this theological discussion about something. Dr. Trill didn't say what. But for about an hour, they just sat there and just talked. And after a while, the white deacon says, okay, I'm sorry, I got to go because I've got a certain number of houses I've got to hit before we get done with this today. And so they just kept going up and down the street, knocking on the doors of people that were different from them. Dr. Trill says, we got done. Those deacons were different. They looked at people differently than they had before. Part of what was pulling that church back was their indifference to that part of the community. Peter's connection to God was impaired by his pride, his poor understanding of God's word, and his indifference. Our connection to God is impaired by our pride, our poor understanding of God's word, and our indifference to those that are different from us. Let's open our eyes. Let's remember that God doesn't desire that anyone not come to Him. God desires all men and women to come back to Him. Christ died that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Whosoever. And I thank God every day for that whosoever includes me. Let's go to the Lord. Lord, our most gracious Heavenly Father. Lord, we just thank you for opening up our eyes just as you opened up Peter's eyes, Father. Lord, you showed him that we should not call anyone unholy or unclean, Father. That you desire all men and all nations to come to you, Father. That you don't desire that anyone should die without having received your Son and chosen to follow him. Father God, help us to open up our eyes to all the opportunities around us, Father. Lord, help us to let go of our pride, Father. Help us to continue to be refreshed and become more familiar with your word, Father. And Lord, help us to care and to love deeply those around us, Father. Help us to be receptive to you, Father. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. If you'd like to receive Jesus in your life, you'd like to make that decision to respond to Christ, let me encourage you to come forward. Perhaps you've already made that decision, and you feel like that, okay, the next step is baptism, because that is the next step. If you're ready for that, let me encourage you to come forward. Perhaps you've already been baptized by immersion, and you're ready to join this fellowship officially. Let me encourage you to come forward as well. Let's all stand together, please. Jesus is tenderly calling. This is Connie and Sal Laguda. They have been attending here quite some time. They have already in times past made a profession of faith and been baptized, but they are coming this morning to officially join this fellowship on a statement of faith, and so I present their marriage in the form of a motion. Do I have a second? All in favor of admitting them in fellowship, let them know by saying, hallelujah! And at the end of the worship service, let me encourage everyone to come by and extend to them the right hand of Christian fellowship. Did you have something you wanted to ask or say? Amen to that. Let's all stand together, please. Have a brief word of prayer, and then we'll have our closing song. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day, Father. We thank you for this time of worship, Father. We thank you for Sal and for Connie, Father, for them coming to join this fellowship officially. Father God,